Good morning, everybody. Welcome to worship, coming at you from Leeds, but wherever you are in the world, welcome to worship with us, Cornerstone Baptist Church. This is a communion service, or at least if you're joining in with the after service watch party on Zoom, if I've worded that correctly, that's where communion will be happening. So if you are joining in with that, please make sure that you've got your bread and your juice ready in good time. I don't know if you know this, but this week is called Organ Donation Week. And I've been thinking about this in preparation for this service, thinking that the organ at Headingley hasn't been used for a long time, the organ at the Headingley site. So given that it's Organ Donation Week, don't you think we should be considering parting with that? Keep your hair on if you're passionate about the Headingley organ. That's not what Organ Donation Week is about. In fact, one of our elders, Joe Walsh, has been very busy recently on the theme of organ donation, and that's a different type of organ donation, in case you're wondering. And later on in the service, Joe will be appearing, letting us know what he's been up to. And I would like to encourage you in advance to prayerfully consider what it is that he will be saying to us. But for now, in this service, we will be finishing our sermon series on the theme of the Holy Spirit. So before we dive in, let's look at something really important about the Holy Spirit as we begin our worship together. This book is called Everything a Child Should Know About God. Great title, right? The first thing that we see is the Holy Spirit is God. And it says this: here is something wonderful to remember. Our Heavenly Father is God. And Jesus is God. And the Holy Spirit is God. And yet, there is only one God. Now we are going to talk about God, the Holy Spirit. He lives in heaven and here on earth. And he lives within his people. He gives us power and he fills us with joy. The people in this picture are God's friends. They have the Holy Spirit within them. And they are joyful and friendly. And another book to help us just as we begin our worship. This is Celtic Daily Prayer. And I'm going to be reading a prayer called The Invocation of the Holy Spirit. After I've read this prayer, we will start to worship God together in song. Let's pray. Most powerful Holy Spirit, come down upon us and subdue us. From heaven, where the ordinary is made glorious and glory seems but ordinary, bathe us with the radiance of your light like dew. Amen. Shout it out, Jesus is alive.
celebrate. Jesus is alive. He's alive. And oh, happy day.
Slain, worthy.
take my place, that you would bear my cross, you would lay down your life, that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me.
Hi there, church family. My name's Joe Walsh. I'm an elder here at Cornerstone. Some of you will know that last year I gave a kidney to a stranger, and since then I've really felt God calling me to raise awareness of altruistic kidney donation to the UK church. That's why I've recently set up an initiative called Faith in Operation, which I'm really excited to see how God will use. More than anything though, I'd really appreciate your prayer and support. Here's a promotional video so you can find out a little bit more.
I wonder if you as a Christian consider yourself to be a transplant recipient. In Ezekiel 36 verse 26, God says, "I will give you a new heart and put a new spirit in you. I will take away your heart of stone and give you a heart of flesh." Through Christ we have become recipients of a heavenly transplant, receiving a new heart so that we can have a passion for God and a countercultural love for the people around us. My name is Joe Walsh. I'm an elder at Cornerstone Baptist Church Leeds and creator of Faith in Operation, a website that encourages Christians to consider giving a kidney to a stranger, what's known as altruistic kidney donation. I started Faith in Operation because I believe that the church shares God's heart for the stranger in need. Christians share this amazing countercultural attitude that their bodies are living sacrifices, and that's why many Christians have given a kidney to a stranger from different backgrounds, including nurses and theologians. I'm confident that in these trying times, Christians like you and I, recipients of God's heart, can love the stranger in amazing ways. I even dare to believe that the church can be instrumental in ending the waiting list for a kidney. Unfortunately, there are thousands of people waiting for a kidney, and hundreds will die whilst still waiting for one. However, many of us have two kidneys, and believe it or not, you can live a perfectly healthy life with just one. Amazingly, someone willing to give a kidney to a stranger can enable a kidney donor chain of up to three transplants. This helps three people to receive a kidney and saves the NHS as much as £600,000. If you're intrigued, please do check out the Faith in Operation website, where you can find all the information you need to explore altruistic kidney donation. Whether or not you can donate a kidney, your prayer support would be really appreciated. Please do go to the website and sign up for the Faith in Operation newsletter. And please also share this video with your church and on social media.
Soon, Hannah Childs will be doing our all-age talk. And in a little while, our senior minister, Peter Morden, will be opening up the word for us on the theme of new life in the Spirit. I'd like to pray for us in a moment, but I just have an encouragement for us before then. And the encouragement is this. If we would like new life from the Holy Spirit, made available through the death and resurrection of Jesus for us, will we ask? Will we ask him? And if we have received new life from the Holy Spirit, will we talk to him? Because if we have received that life, he's in us and with us all the time. And it'd be pretty wrong and pretty rude to forget about him or to ignore him. I'm sure that if you pray, you'll probably pray to God the Father, and there's nothing wrong with that, or to Jesus the Son, who is also God, and there's nothing wrong with that either. But do you also pray to the Holy Spirit, who is also God? Do you talk to him on a daily basis and ask him to fill you with the life that Jesus came to make available for you? I'm not preaching today, so I'll stop there with the questions, but I believe they're appropriate to ask. Let me pray for us, and then Hannah, I believe, will take over from there. Holy Spirit, thank you that you are God on earth, that the life that Jesus came to give is freely available for all who believe, because you are freely available for all who believe. So please, wherever we are at in our faith and life and our relationship with you, please help us to trust in you more. Holy Spirit, please help us to talk to you. And Lord, may we also begin to grow in confidence and competence at hearing you speak back to us. Whatever it is that Hannah has to say, whatever it is that Peter has to say, and whatever happens for the rest of the service, may we not just hear the voices of human beings, but may we hear your voice, the living God, speaking to us, that we might grow in relationship with you and share your love and your life with those we come into contact with. Holy Spirit, please have your way in this service, in this time. For we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Good morning, Cornerstone family. It's Hannah here. Well, this morning I wanted to talk to you about doppelgangers. Doppelgangers are two people who look the same but aren't related. 3 years ago, I was at a conference called Naturally Supernatural here in the UK. I was serving on the children's team, having an absolute blast. Fast forward a year and I was in South Africa, and I was working at a place called the Live Village, also having an absolute blast working with the children there. And two of the volunteers that I was working with, on the first time that I met them, they came up to me and they asked me if I was at Naturally Supernatural the year before. And I said, yeah, I was there. And they said, yeah, because we think we saw you there. We think, we remember seeing you in the canteen getting your food. And I was getting a bit like, oh, this is a bit creepy, them spying on me. And then they told me that it was because every time they saw me, they thought they were seeing their friend called Holly, and that we looked really, really similar. And so when they'd seen me in South Africa a year later, they thought it was hilarious because they'd seen me again. The coincidence is just beyond me. They showed me a picture, and trust me, we looked so alike, it was unreal. Maybe a more normal example of this, or more common example of this, is twins, where two people look the same, but they are related. My dad is a twin, and him and my uncle Gordon do look really similar. And here's a picture of them when they were kids. And honestly, no one in our family except their mum can tell them apart in this picture. My dad looks at the picture and he goes, I think I'm on the left. And then he'll have a look at the person on the right and he'll go, oh no, actually, I think I'm on the right. He has no clue. They look exactly the same. Here's another question. What does our church look like? I mean, I don't think I'm talking about the outside appearances. We have three wonderful buildings where we meet and gather, usually in Leeds. We've got Bramley and Horsforth and Headingley. But that's not what the passage from the Bible that we're looking at is talking about. See, our passage is from Ephesians this week, and the book of Ephesians is a letter that is written from Paul to the people who lived in Ephesus. And Paul said to these people, he said, there are only two types of churches. He said, there's ones that look like the world. Here's a picture, a map of the world. And if you look like the world, you are acting and looking like non-believers around you. You might be lying and stealing and saying bad things. And as you do that, you begin to think like that too, and you become like that. The other option is that you would look like Jesus. I have a little candle here to represent looking like Jesus. And if you are thinking and looking like Jesus as much as you can, you're going to shine bright like this candle. Our passage today, Paul asks, who do you look like? Do you look like the world, or do you look like Jesus? And you might think that it doesn't matter, but there's so much at stake here. If we say we are Christians, if we have that badge on our chest, but all that we do, all that we say, all of our actions, and maybe even some of our thoughts look like the world, then we're not going to be showing the world what Jesus is really like. However, if our doppelganger is Jesus, if we're doing everything in our power to become more and more like Jesus, then we're going to shine brighter than ever, and we're going to be going down the right path. We're going to stand out, and people are going to spot us in the street, maybe not quite in the street, but they're going to spot us in our workplaces, in our schools, in our universities and colleges, and they're going to want to know why we are different, why we stand out from the crowd, and what makes us kind and compassionate and slow to anger, all those wonderful characteristics that God has. And that's the exciting thing, because that's when we get to tell them that it's because we know Jesus. What an exciting prospect, and what a challenge too. Who do you think you're more like today? Are you like the world, or are you like Jesus? Amen.
This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. Every day, every day, every day, every day, every day, every day, gonna let my little light shine. Jesus gave me light, I'm gonna let it shine. Jesus gave me light, I'm gonna let it shine. Jesus gave me light, I'm gonna let it shine. Every day, every day, every day, every day, every day, every day, gonna let my little light shine. Shine. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. Every day, every day, every day, every day, every day, every day, gonna let my little light shine.
Good morning, my name's Tracy, and I'm the cafe manager of the Greenhouse Cafe based here in Headingley. The cafe is open on a Tuesday and Wednesday from 8:30 to 2 p.m. We'd love for you to come and join us in a COVID-secure environment. It's my pleasure this morning to be asked to lead prayers this week. Let us take a minute to pause and reflect on God. Please, God, help everyone involved in the planning of the two events that are hoping to start this coming week. We pray for Kate Birkett and her team to have the knowledge and understanding of the government guidelines to enable the Cafe Tots event to go ahead as planned and to be enjoyable but a safe witness to all who attend. Heavenly Father, we also pray for the planning and preparation of the afternoon tea service that will go ahead this week, and that it will enable those people who have not yet been able to engage with our online services to meet together and worship you in a secure place. Lord God, this morning we also pray for Joe Walsh, who has been organising publicity for the Organ Donor Week, which ends today. We ask that it would reach the right people and that this publicity would continue, and you would continue to call more people to consider this journey of organ donation. We ask for a sense of peace for those people who have already come forward along this journey. Heavenly Father, we ask you to help Joe to assist and support those people who are travelling along this road already. Amen.
Today's reading is taken from Ephesians chapter 4, verse 17 to 32. Instructions for Christian Living. So I tell you this, and insist on it in the Lord, that you must no longer live as the Gentiles do, in the futility of their thinking. They are darkened in their understanding and separated from the life of God, because of the ignorance that is in them due to the hardening of their hearts. Having lost all sensitivity, they have given themselves over to sensuality, as to indulge in every kind of impurity, and they are full of greed. That, however, is not the way of life you learned when you heard about Christ and were taught in him in accordance with the truth that is in Jesus. You were taught with regard to your former way of life to put off your old self, which is being corrupted by its deceitful desires, to be made new in the attitude of your mind, and to put on the new self, created to be like God in true righteousness and holiness. Therefore, each of you must put off falsehood and speak truthfully to your neighbour, for we are all members of one body. In your anger, do not sin. Do not let the sun go down while you are still angry, and do not give the devil a foothold. Anyone who has been stealing must steal no longer, but must work, doing something useful with their own hands, that they may have something to share with those in need. Do not let any unwholesome talk come out of your mouths, but only what is helpful for building others up according to their needs, that it may benefit those who listen. And do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God, with whom you were sealed for the day of redemption. Get rid of all bitterness, rage and anger, brawling and slander, along with every form of malice. Be kind and compassionate to one another, forgiving each other, just as in Christ God forgave you. This is the word of the Lord.
What does it mean to be filled with the Holy Spirit? Christians might answer that question in a number of different ways. For example, we might say, well, someone who is filled with the Spirit, they are a person who is a passionate worshipper. That's what it looks like to be filled with the Holy Spirit. Alternatively, someone might say, well, it's a very gifted person, someone who has received many of the gifts of the Holy Spirit and is putting them into practice in their daily lives. And it's important to note that those two things, they are part of the answer to the question. Someone who is filled with the Holy Spirit is likely indeed to be a passionate worshipper of God. Indeed, we see that in Ephesians. In Ephesians chapter 5, we read in verse 18 the encouragement to be filled with the Spirit. And then following straight on from that, speaking to one another with psalms, hymns, and songs from the Spirit. Sing and make music from your heart to the Lord. So immediately after the encouragement, the invitation to be filled with the Spirit, we see words about worship. Someone who is filled with the Spirit is going to be a passionate worshipper. And just as an aside, if you have found this time of lockdown difficult because you've not been able to meet physically with your friends, your fellow church members, and you've not been able to praise God together, you've really missed that, then that's a sign that you're filled with the Holy Spirit. You have a desire to worship God. You want to praise him in the midst of his people. And it's the same for gifts. You know, it's an important part of how we answer the question. And again, we can turn to Ephesians, talking about the Holy Spirit. The Spirit has been given, and there are gifts that are given out, and some are listed in Ephesians 4. Apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastor, teachers, and there are many, many other gifts, different lists in the New Testament. A Spirit-filled person is going to be someone who will use their God-given gifts in the service of the church and in the wider community. So this is part of the answer for us. But it's not the whole answer. You know, it's great to be a passionate worshipper of God. It's great to have gifts that we're using in God's service. That's part of the answer of what it means to be filled with the Holy Spirit. But it's not the whole answer. Indeed, I think I would argue that it's not the primary thing. That the primary thing is how we live. Gifts are vital, but godliness is more vital still. I've met a number of people in my life who have been very gifted, involved in Christian ministry, but have struggled with godliness. And having seen that, if I had a choice between gifts and godliness, I would want to go for godliness in a person every time. Obviously, it's good to have both. It's good to be gifted and godly. But godliness is actually primary. Being filled with the Holy Spirit is to do with how we live our lives day to day. And so we turn to this passage in Ephesians 4, and the verses that follow on from verse 17. And we see life in the Holy Spirit. There's a number of things here. And we see, first of all, in verse 22, that there is something here to do with putting off and putting on. This is an image that Paul uses very often about the Christian life. It's also in Colossians 3, for example. We are to put off the old and put on the new, the old way of life that belongs to the time before we embrace the gospel, and the gospel way of living that we are now to put on. It's like taking off and putting on a different set of clothes. I've got my grey sweatshirt on, and just to illustrate this, this might go badly wrong, but I'm going to take this off. Know why I thought this was a good idea, and I'm going to put something else on. So I've got a red sweatshirt here, and I'm going to slip this on. So it's out with the old and in with the new. And in this particular instance, the new is a bit more colourful and a bit more lively. And of course, the new stuff that we are to put on, the new way of living that goes with the power of the Holy Spirit, that is colourful and attractive and wonderful. You see someone who truly has life in the Spirit. And it's not dour and dull, it's exciting and it's fresh and it's different. So put off the old and put on the new. Not going to spend too much time thinking about the old, but I just want us to notice one thing from verse 22 of Ephesians 4, where Paul talks about deceitful desires. The original phrase might be better translated something like the desires of deceit, and it's a way of expressing that it's not so much the people who have these desires who are deceitful, but there is something deceitful about the desires themselves, in that wrong desires promise much but deliver little. The desires themselves are deceitful. And I just want to spend a moment on this. We might think about shopping, consumerism, materialism, and how actually it promises something really good. It's bright and shiny, and we think if we buy this new thing that we don't really need, then we will be happy and we will be fulfilled. But when we do that, we so often find it's a disappointment. Whole range of cultural commentators, both Christian and secular, point this out, that actually to pursue consumerism, it's always a disappointment. You always need just a little bit more. You buy that thing and you think it's going to make you happy, but actually you've got two or three like that in the wardrobe anyway, and it's not quite right. And that thing that you bought on impulse, well, you don't really need it. And it's disappointing. It's unsatisfying. There is a desire there that promises much, but the desire in and of itself is deceitful. What it promises, it doesn't deliver. Another different example might be sexual promiscuity. Again, for someone who is tempted to engage in that, or perhaps begins to engage in that, it seems to promise much, the fulfillment of desire. But again, the desire fails to deliver. It wrecks the life of someone who engages in that and seeds a bitter harvest for so many other people. There is a promise, but the promise is not kept. There is a desire, but the desire fails to lead to fulfillment when that desire is pursued. Maybe that just as we're talking about these things and we're thinking about the deceitfulness of these wrong desires, that you recognize that to one degree or another, you're on the wrong path and God is calling you back. Calling you back to something that is bright and wonderful and truly fulfilling, the Christian way. Because God is a promise keeper, not a promise breaker. And if our desires are for him and for the new way of life that he sets out for us, then we will find that ultimately fulfilling and wonderful. It is life now and life in the age to come, life in all its fullness, as Jesus said. So don't fall for the deceitfulness of old desires. Rather, take off the old and put on the new. And so down to specifics, down to brass tacks. And there's a number of things that the Apostle Paul sets out here to do with words and actions. So just focus on three. First of all, don't steal but work in verse 28. It's a bit of a shock that this is there in a Christian letter written to Christian churches, but it's there and we need to reckon with it. The person who is stealing should stop. And there are, of course, a whole range of ways that we can do that, from massaging tax returns to all sorts of other things that we maybe explain away. Don't do that, the Apostle Paul says. That doesn't belong to life in the Spirit. Build up, but don't tear down. Be truthful and loving with the words that we say. Still okay to be challenging, but we should be helpful. So build up and don't tear down. And then in verse 32, forgive one another, even as Christ forgave you. What an extraordinary and wonderful challenge that is. Jesus has forgiven us 70 times 7. Over and over again, he forgives us. And we are called to forgive one another. And actually, it's good for us. Unforgiveness, when we hold it in our hearts, just seeds a bitter harvest in our lives. The root of bitterness takes root. It puts down deep roots into our hearts and our life, and it can cause untold problems. We forgive one another because it's a gospel imperative. We forgive because we have been forgiven. But we also forgive because if we don't, it twists us up and it pulls us down. Don't steal, but work. Build one another up. Forgive one another. That's a glorious set of things that belong to the new way of life. And notice this, that it really is to do with one another. We find our joy as we grow in our passion for God and as we share that with one another. And all of these things are to do with how we relate to others. We see in the one about stealing. Why should we not steal? Why should we work hard? Well, it's not so that we can have a lot of money to spend. It's not so we can have a lot of money to save. It's so that we have something to share with those in need. It's to do with others. And as far as using our words to build one another up is concerned, as far as forgiving one another is concerned, that is clearly, by definition, to do with how we relate to other people. And you can't do those things in not so splendid isolation. You have to be with others. And so this is to do with others. Certainly, it's to do with the household of faith, but also we can put this into practice in the wider world. Verse 18 talks about darkness and how people can be darkened in their understanding. And we live in a time of darkness. I'm recording this on Thursday morning. The announcements are now out about the restriction on social gatherings. Only 6 people, either inside or outside. And also here in Leeds, in our own city, the number of coronavirus infections, about 60 per 100,000, and the very real possibility of some lockdown measures being reimposed in our city. And there is darkness, and there is frustration, and there is sadness. And we are called in this dark situation to be lights, to work hard, to be honest, to build people up and to forgive in your family, in your workplace, in the wider community. These are all dimensions of life in the Spirit that we can put into practice. I want to encourage us all today to be reflecting the light of God into the dark situations that we see. Earlier this week, I was doing some teaching for Transformations Leeds International Student Work here in Leeds, and Phil Thomas, who is the director of Transformations Leeds, led our prayer time, and he talked about the need for light in society. Can I try this? Got a light there, and just lighting a candle. There we are. One of the things we did was to take a light and we put it down on a map of the UK, and people were putting their lights down in various places. I put mine down in Leeds as a sign that I wanted to reflect the light of God here in this wonderful city, in our church community, in our different gatherings and sites, but also in the wider community. Not stealing, working hard, having something to share, building people up and forgiving one another. These dimensions of life in the Spirit bring light in the darkness, light in COVID-19 coronavirus darkness, light where there is threat of redundancy, where there are financial issues, where there is sickness, perhaps. May we, whom God lights, be light to the world this week. What does it mean to be filled with the Holy Spirit? Absolutely passionate worship, absolutely giftedness, but a godly, light-filled life lived in the community is wonderful life in the Spirit. It is the need of the hour. May God light each one of us this week and help us to share him in the darkness. Like never before.
praise unending. 10,000 years and then forevermore. Bless the Lord, O my soul, O my soul, worship His holy name. Sing like never before, O my soul, I'll worship Your.
Sacrifice of a broken heart. Jesus, what can I give? What can I bring to so faithful a friend, to so loving a king? Savior, what can be said? What can be sung as a praise of Your name for the things You have done? Words could not tell, not even in part, of the debt of love that is owed by this thankful heart. You deserve my every breath, for You've paid the great cost, giving up Your life to death, even death on a cross. You took all my shame away, there defeated my sin, opened up the gates of hell, and have beckoned me in. Jesus, what can I give? What can I bring to so faithful a friend, to so loving a king? Savior, what can be said? What can be sung as a praise of Your name for the things You have done? Oh, my words could not tell, not even in part, of the debt of love that is owed by this thankful heart.
It's been great that you've connected with this service. Thank you to those who've made this service possible. Please remember that if you would like to join in for communion on Zoom straight after the service, that you will need your bread and your juice ready. Jesus tells us in John chapter 10 that He came that we might know life, and life in all its fullness. Not just the ability to breathe or survive, but to live, to really live. Do you know that life that He came to bring? Do you want it? Do you want to know what it means to truly live? For your soul to truly live? If so, please contact us and talk to us if that's you. The life that Jesus came to make available is possible. It's available through the power of the Holy Spirit. These are not just words, this is reality. So may we all know that life that life in all its fullness. In Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you. Have a great week. Jesus loves you. Receive the life he came to give.